Hi everyone, I'm so happy to meet you all again in this program. This is the episode of conclusion for the seven feasts of the Lord. In this episode, we will go through all the seven feasts of the Lord, which shows God's salvation plan for human from the sins of the world and transform them to be the sons of God.
It was on the top of Mount Sinai that God gave Moses the dates and observances of the seven feasts of the Lord, which are the Feast of Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of First Fruits, the Feast of Pentecost, the Feast of Trumpets, the Feast of Day of Atonement, the Feast of Tabernacles. These seven feasts of the Lord has past, present, and future prophetic meaning.
Hi Jill, welcome to the show.
Hi Maria, it's so good to be back.
Yeah, this is the last and final episode of this series.
Yeah, it's been great.
We have been talking about the feast for over 8 episodes, I think.
Yeah, it's hard to believe how fast they went by, right?
Yeah, but in this episode, we are going to take a recap of every feast. And we are going to have a connection with the feast and Messiah's ministry and also the end of the world.
Okay, that's a good kind of summary.
Explain to me about the word feast.
In Hebrew?
Yeah, in Hebrew.
There's actually two major words that are used throughout the Bible, and they each have a slightly different feeling, but they're both used about what we call feasts. One is moed. Moed means an appointed time or season. We see it as early as Genesis, when God created the sun and the moon and the stars for times and seasons. Those are called, in plural, moedim.
Moedim, yeah.
The other word that's used is mikra. A mikra means a holy convocation, a solemn assembly, or it can even mean a rehearsal for things to come. Yeah. So that kind of gives us that feeling that they're holy assemblies, but they're also appointed times that the Lord owns, not people.
The world usually thinks these feasts are only for Jewish and for the Old Testament.
Well, originally, they were given at Mount Sinai. Originally, Moses was given them for the children of Israel. So I can understand why people might think it's just really Jewish holidays. But all through the Bible, you never once hear him say, these are the Jewish holidays, or these are Israel's holidays. He always says, these are my appointed times. The Lord always says they're his. And if they're his, and if he now has a company from all the nations, a bride who loves him and is one with him, shouldn't they have the same opportunity to encounter his heart in his own feasts? I believe they're for all of us. And I believe in the feasts, maybe Israel can lead the way in teaching the nations how Moses wrote about them and how they mean in Hebrew. But ultimately, they're for all his children. And he made that very clear to me personally, even when he commissioned me to begin writing and teaching about these feasts.
But people think only it's for Jewish and just for in the Old Testament feasts, right?
They think it, but I believe he's beginning to open many eyes. I think one of the reasons he even asked me to write this book, it wasn't for the Jewish people. Okay. They already knew about it. It was for all of his bride from the nations. He said, I want you to invite them in. So we know that God is really beckoning the people to come in.
Okay. So do we have the evidence that during the first century period, the Christians celebrated the feast?
Oh, absolutely. When we carefully read the Gospels and the Book of Acts, the first thing we see is that all of the original apostles and disciples were Jews, both men and women.
Yeah.
And we also see that the only holidays any of them ever celebrated were what are called the biblical feasts. And if you'd like, I could even show you a couple scriptures that documents that from the New Testament. I won't read them, I'll just give you the addresses so your listeners can perhaps look them up a little bit later. But we see in John chapter 10, verse 22, Luke chapter 22, verses 7 to 8,
yeah.
Acts 20, verse 6, and 1 Corinthians 16, verse 8. These are just a few examples where the early apostles celebrated the feasts. In one case, Paul was on his missionary journeys to all the nations, but he said, I've got to get back to Jerusalem in time for Pentecost. And he didn't explain it because his readers would have understood he was a Jewish man obeying the Lord and getting back to Jerusalem in time to celebrate the feast in Jerusalem.
Okay, so in the first centuries, they celebrated the feast.
Absolutely.
Then, why have Christians lost connection with these Jewish
roots? Yeah, that's a big question. Interestingly, until about 330 AD, even the Gentile converts to Christianity were also keeping the feasts up till that time.
Okay.
They understood that, you know, Yeshua, Jesus said, salvation is from the Jews. And he said, Moses is preached on every street corner.
Yeah.
So in other words, they were learning from the Jewish believers until something happened. Something changed in around 312 AD. The Roman Emperor Constantine converted to Christianity.
Okay.
And it seemed like a good thing at the time, and he did some good things. But one of the bad things he did was he outlawed Judaism. And he gradually began to make laws saying that Christians were forbidden to either go to a synagogue, read the Bible in Hebrew, celebrate Passover, keep the Shabbat. And this was gradual. But we see these councils of church elders. And remember, at that time, there were no more Jewish original apostles. They had died off by that time. Whether, you know, Paul, Peter, James, most of them were martyred. John lived the longest of any of them. But most of them were gone by that point. And so the Gentile church began to outnumber the Jewish believers at that point, and these laws were passed. And so really that has never been corrected. From all the way back to the 300s, we see that the Roman church, the Catholic church, and later even the Protestant church still maintained the errors of Constantine and still said, Easter has nothing to do with Passover.
Yeah.
Sunday has nothing to do with Saturday. We want nothing to do with those Jewish holidays and special days. And they just cut them off. And it wasn't just a mistake. It was a deliberate choice, which I believe was inspired by the devil, to cut the roots off the tree and make them lost in terms of the covenants of God. So that's a short version of the history.
Did Moses get the teaching from the Lord about the feast on Mount Sinai?
Yes, all of the primary teachings of Moses, including the feast teachings, were part of that larger Sinai revelation that we find in the whole first five books of Moses. It's quite a lot of revelation.
About the feast, he got it there?
Yes, he got all of it, plus all of the other aspects of the law too.
So if Moses got there, then during the 40 years of wilderness, did they celebrate all the feasts?
Well, that's really an interesting question, did they?
Yeah.
Let's look at them one at a time and just try to answer that and make sense of it.
Okay, the first one is Passover?
Yeah, the first one is Passover. So, of course, they celebrated that before they even got to Mount Sinai because they were escaping from Egypt at least about 3 months before.
Yes.
And so, yes, they kept the Passover because the blood of that lamb actually protected their families from the angel of death slaying the firstborn. And we know for the entire time of the desert wanderings, they would have kept the Passover for absolutely sure.
So this, the next one.
Yeah, the next one, let's say unleavened bread. Well, we have to think about that. Unleavened bread means, well, you're baking your bread, but you don't put any yeast in your bread.
Yes.
Now, where did they get their bread for 40 years?
No, they got only manna.
Manna from the sky. So did God put yeast in it?
No.
We have no idea.
Yeah.
So they really couldn't have kept the Feast of Unleavened Bread except by eating the pure manna that came down from heaven. So that's the second one.
Second and third.
First fruits.
Yeah.
Now that one, God specifically said, now remember, we're talking about barley.
Yeah.
Okay. Could they grow barley as they wandered from the wilderness to the wilderness?
No, they don't have their own lands.
No. Yeah. They didn't have farms.
Yeah.
They didn't have a steady source of water.
Yeah.
And they weren't settling down to plant for a whole year at a time. Whenever the cloud of glory moved, they had to move. So God specifically said about first fruits, when I bring you into the land that I promised you, and when you have your fields, and when you plow, and when you sow, and when you reap, then you will remember and bring me your first fruits. So that one we know that they did
after the promised land.
Yeah, they could only do that when they when they had it to eat. So that was the third one. Okay, now the fourth feast.
Pentecost,
that's right. So that one is about the wheat harvest. Yeah. So once again, don't we have the same problem? No harvest, no wheat, no Pentecost. Okay, so then the fifth one is?
It's the trumpet.
That's right, the Feast of Trumpets. So they would have definitely kept that, because didn't they have enough rams in the desert to have ram's
horns?
So
they would have blown,
They would have definitely blown the shofar. So they would keep that in the desert. Yom Kippur, I would feel certain that they would have kept that.
Atonement for that,
Yeah, they would. In fact, that was part of the desert ritual, was every year he went into that tent of meeting. That was the highlight of their year in the desert. It's probably the only thing that kept them alive, because they were sinful, you know? And then, so what's the last feast?
Tabernacle.
Right. Do you think they did that in the desert?
Because they were in the tabernacle.
Right. Yeah. You could say they didn't keep it because they were already stuck in the desert.
They are in the struggle, right?
Exactly. So the real tabernacles later was remembering those days when they lived in tents.
Yeah.
So we could pretty much say they didn't fully get to celebrate it there.
They would have celebrated only the three feasts, maybe.
Yeah. Yeah. And tabernacles, but only to the degree that they were already living it up.
We just compare all these feasts with the Lord Jesus' ministry and its fulfillment.
Okay. Like a shadow, or how he actually fulfilled it?
Actually fulfilled.
How he actually fulfilled it? Well, we could just look at it one at a time again?
Yeah, okay.
Okay. So Passover, remember the original. We had a lamb and the blood. We had a plague of death, and the angel stopped when it saw the blood.
Yeah.
So when Jesus went to the cross, he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood." He said, it remits your sins. It atones for your sins. It takes your sins away. And the law of sin is death. The wages of sin is death.
Yeah.
So if he takes away our sin, it means the angel of death can't come and get us, just like in Egypt. So he fulfilled that on the cross by saying, the blood stops it. The blood stops sin and the blood stops death.
Yeah.
As far as unleavened bread, he was the only man who's ever lived who had no sin. He didn't even have a sinful motive in his heart. It's almost impossible to picture that, but that's really how he lived. And so his body could not decay in the ground. Death and bacteria could not eat up his dead body because he was too full of life. Even though he gave up the ghost, he gave up his spirit, that was only because he had to as a sacrifice, but even death couldn't really take him.
Mm-hmm.
And so he fulfilled unleavened bread completely by rising up without any decay having happened to his body.
And then the third one.
It's really the same thing, first fruits.
First fruit, yeah.
He was the first fruits from the dead.
Yeah.
And Paul tells us Jesus is our first fruits from the dead. And so remember that first fruits is a guarantee of a future harvest. So in the same way that the first actual fruits guarantee more fruits later, one dead person coming alive forever in his glorified body guarantees millions of resurrected saints in the days to come. So he'll even fulfill that one more when he comes back and resurrects all of us.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Then Pentecost.
Then Pentecost. He fulfilled that largely on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after he was raised from the dead. He poured out the Holy Spirit on all of those first 3,000 Jewish men in Jerusalem, and then they took the Holy Spirit out to the rest of the world. So he mostly fulfilled that feast back then.
Okay.
Now, as for trumpets, what do you think? Has it been fulfilled yet?
I think maybe the coming days?
Yeah, I think it's future.
Yeah.
Because how many scriptures tell us the trumpet will sound, you will hear a loud blast, and the heavens will roll up like a scroll, and you'll see the sign of the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. We see scripture after scripture that connects the blast of the trumpet with the second coming. So I would say that, and also in addition, the other two fall feasts, the autumn feasts, will only fully be fulfilled. Yeah, let's look at Yom Kippur first. He has fulfilled it in some sense, because when he died, he took his own blood up to the altar, and he did sprinkle it as the greater Aaron, the greater high priest. He sprinkled it on the Holy of Holies, not the earthly one, but the heavenly one, which prepared a way for all of us to boldly come before the throne of grace. So he did fulfill it to a large degree, but I feel it won't ultimately be fulfilled until we look upon him, we Jewish people that we have pierced, and we mourn for him and have that national day of atonement. I think that will be the greater fulfillment of that feast. And then that brings us to tabernacles.
This last one?
Yeah, he has fulfilled it in part, but not fully. You notice that pattern. It's not just a one-time fulfillment with any prophecy. There's always partial fulfillments along the way. And if we did a study, you would see this pattern over and over. So with tabernacles, hey, in the desert, he already was partly fulfilling it. He said, I dwell in tents with you. That was a fulfillment. Even when he walked with Adam in the cool of the day, it was a partial fulfillment. But as we look ahead to the birth of the Lord Jesus, that was a bigger partial, because it said the Word became flesh and tabernacled among us.
Yeah.
But was that the final? Not yet.
Yeah, it's so, the millennial kingdom.
Yes. And so it just keeps getting better and better. And finally, when it comes down in the millennial kingdom, that's a huge fulfillment, but it's not the last one. There's even one more.
Yeah.
The eternal Jerusalem comes down. It says very clearly in Revelation, at the end of the millennial 1,000 years, the eternal city comes down. And then it says, God, meaning the Father, will dwell with man, and his feet will walk on the earth forever with him, in the new heavens and the new earth. So it really does keep going all the way till the eternal state.
Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah, you have already said about the prophetic shadows also with this.
Yeah, I think we've kind of shared the shadows, that each one was a, each feast was a shadow of what he would do.
Yeah.
And now we've just looked back and said what he did do.
Yeah.
So I think we've covered that part.
If our listeners wants more details about these feasts, you would like to say about your book, because you have written about the feast in your book very detailedly. The book named, I think, A Prophetic Calendar.
Yeah.
So do you want to explain about it?
Sure, sure. This is the second book that the Lord asked me to write. It's called A Prophetic Calendar, The Feasts of Israel.
Recently, I've quoted some of the verses from there.
Yes,
right?
I quoted a few, just a few tiny parts of it on today's discussion. This book, actually, a publisher, Destiny Image, asked me if I would write this book. And I thought, well, we don't need another book about the feast, because there were already some fairly good books on the market. But I told them I'd pray about it for a little while.
How would you write this?
Well,
with the datas or with those prophetic words?
Well, it's an amazing combination of research, but more by the Spirit of God. When I finally knew the Lord, this is what he said to me. This was the one sentence he said to me. Can you help my flock find my heart in my own feasts? And that sentence, it's written in this book, that changed the whole character. It was no longer just research. He said, I'm inviting my bride from all the nations to come and understand my heart, not to learn every perfect Hebrew word and not to become Jewish and not to have to follow these laws and rules, but to see what I meant in each feast and how I am the living fulfillment. And so the book is full of prophetic words. I waited on the Lord after every chapter, and I said, have I found your heart in this feast? And then I waited, and I thought he would just say either yes or no, but he didn't. He gave me a whole prophetic word after every single chapter in this book. And they're very powerful words for the bride of Christ from all the nations. And it helps them celebrate in an easy way. It makes the feast like, oh no, this is not just one more thing I have to do. Nobody has to do it. It's a joy.
It's a joy.
But for those who want to do it, this book makes it really, really easy for them. And I'm not boasting when I say that the heart of the Lord Jesus is really in this book. And people that read it really connect to him through a new lens, through a new understanding of his heart.
Do you like to share anything to our viewers?
And just speak right to them?
Yeah, please.
All right, Maria, thank you. Dearly beloved bride of the Lord Jesus Christ, Yeshua our Lord, I'm just so happy to be invited into your homes as you watch this conversation. My heart is so full of the love of our bridegroom King Yeshua, the Lord Jesus, and he has such a great love for you. And we've been speaking about the feasts, not just as if a college course or some academic training, but we're speaking about the feasts because they are his calendar. Those are the days and the times that are so precious to him. And not just for something to do, but because they share a part of his heart. Sometimes people tell you about themselves in words, like they say, I'm a doctor and this is where I live and this is what I do. But sometimes they share an experience with you and they say, let's do this together. And you get to know each other better through that experience. And I think the feasts are one of those things that when you sit down at a Passover Seder, or when you celebrate tabernacles, or just celebrate when you bring in the harvest, it really touches the Lord's heart. And the most of all, he really wants you to know his son, Jesus. And he doesn't want you to know about him and know all these facts about him that you can learn in a book. He wants you to know him, the living word. And he wants you to talk to him like he's your best friend. And he wants you to love him with all your heart and all your soul and all your strength. And it's something that it's just between you and him. It doesn't matter what anybody else thinks about you or what you look like on the outside. His eyes look right into the heart, and he's looking for a heart that loves him the way he loves you. And so I want to encourage you, if you have any guilt or shame or anger in your life, don't hide it. Don't be behind a secret place. Go to Jesus. Tell him everything. He knows it anyway. So you're not telling him something he doesn't already know. But the good part about telling him is he will lift it off of you with his grace and with his love. He'll never hold it against you on Judgment Day if you tell him now. So share everything that's in your heart, the good, the bad, and the ugly. That's what I do. I have a lot of shame in my life sometimes, but I give it all to him. And he's faithful to take it away. And if you have guilt, if you've done something and you just can't forgive yourself, you need to take that to Jesus, because he died on the cross to take that away. He doesn't want you to walk around in unforgiveness against yourself or against any of your brothers and sisters. You must forgive others and you must forgive yourself, because he forgives you. And so it's important that you know this man, Jesus. He's the Jewish Messiah, but he's for everyone that was ever born. Jew, Gentile, Indian, French, Chinese, everyone. He's for all of us. And so after you hear this message, if it touches your heart, go in your room, try to shut the door, maybe just for a few minutes. If you're at work, go in the bathroom and shut the door. But just say a little prayer and let him know that you want him to have absolute lordship and leadership over your life. And I promise you that he will make all things new. He will make the wrong things right, not instantly, but he will do it, because he's a God of justice and he's fighting for you, not against you. He's a God of love and he will never turn you away, and his favor will always rest on you if you rely only on him, you lean on him, and you tell him everything that's in your heart. And I'm from Jerusalem, Israel. And I'm bringing all the love of Israel and the Jewish people to you and the nations, so that you can receive the blessing from Zion. Yivarechecha Adonai v'yishmarecha, ya'er Adonai panavelecha v'yichunecha, yisa Adonai panavelecha v'yasem lechem shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord Jesus lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace, his shalom. In the name of our Prince of Peace, Yeshua. Amen.
All seven feasts point to and are fulfilled in the Lord Yeshua. These feasts are separated into two seasons, the spring feast and the fall feast. Lord Yeshua was crucified on the Feast of Passover. He was then buried on the Feast of Unleavened Bread and was resurrected on the Feast of First Fruits. 50 days later, the Holy Spirit was given to us on Pentecost. Now the entire human race exists between the Feast of the Spring and Fall, which represent the church age. The Lord is harvesting believers, patiently beckoning those who follow Him until the fall feasts come. These fall feasts are to be fulfilled in the second coming of the Lord Yeshua. And the first of these is the Feast of Trumpets, and this represents the rapture of the church. While the Feast of Atonement represents the second coming, and the Feast of Tabernacles represents the kingdom age of the Lord. Lord Yeshua himself has said, "Behold, I am coming quickly."
Thank you so much, Jeff. You have given a good explanation about this feast on all these episodes. May the viewers would have got a good understanding about this feast. They may come to a good conclusion also.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
You're so welcome. It's really been a joy to talk to you and also to all those listening. And I bless all of you in Yeshua's name.
Thank you.
Amen.
Episodes that you are watching for past many weeks, we have explored how the seven feasts of the Lord fulfilled in the ministry of Lord Yeshua and the shadows of end time fulfillment. We have fulfilled the will of God through these programs. I'll meet you in another program. Till then, it's bye from Maria.